ఫ్రెండ్స్ వెల్కమ్ టు ద 66th ఎడిషన్ ఆఫ్ లీగల్ ఎంపవర్మెంట్ త్రూ ఇంటరాక్షన్ లెక్చర్ సిరీస్ ఎస్ యూజువల్ ద జర్నీ కంటిన్యూస్ వి హ్యావ్ న్యూ థాట్స్ న్యూ ఐడియాస్ అండ్ వీల్ డిబేట్ వీ మే డిస్ప్యూట్ వీ మే డిఫర్ బట్ ఇన్ ద ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ ఇన్ ద ఎండ్ ఆఫ్ ద డే వీ డెఫినెట్లీ విల్ బి ఎంపవర్డ్ ఎ బిట్ అట్ లీస్ట్ బై ద న్యూ థాట్స్ ద న్యూ అప్రోచెస్ దట్ టు విచ్ వి ఆర్ ఎక్స్పోజ్ టుడే వి ఆర్ ఫార్చునేట్ టు హ్యావ్ ఎ వండర్ఫుల్ స్పీకర్ Thanks to Prem Raj for introducing the speaker to this platform. Justice Roshan Dalvi, she was a former judge of High Court of Bombay. And also we are blessed with the presence of Justice K. Ramakrishnan and Justice V. Ramkumar, sir. And all of you wonderful participants who have been there in this journey for the last 65 sessions. Today, we'll hear from our speaker something we usually thought or took it for granted. Usually it just happens. It's a miracle that our work goes on. We never had applied any concrete thoughts or definite thoughts on how to manage things. It is case management and court management. This being a very informal platform, ma'am, directly to you.
Thank you, friends. And good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Nice to have you here on a Sunday afternoon after a heavy lunch. And to begin with, I would say that every single human endeavor needs management. Without management, there would be mismanagement. And with mismanagement, we don't come out well in the society. So today, if you are sitting without any tension, listening to me after your heavy lunch, there has to have been very good kitchen management in your home. And you must thank your wife or your mother. And of course, if you are a female like me, then you can thank yourself because I've done everything myself. I've managed my kitchen and now I'm telling you how I'd manage my court. So, friends, let us only understand that we as a nation have come out with flying colors in substantive law. Our Supreme Court judgments are cited in England, America, Canada, just as we cite their judgments and take their points of view. But when it comes to procedural law, we lack profusely. No one really looks up to us. Everyone thinks when we do something good, that it has been done after so long, what is the use? And when we don't do it, they say, you are still working and working and you've done nothing. I know one of my chief justices, Justice Mohit Shah, who was saying that when we cannot take up the matters, the people cry out from the rooftops that our matters are not taken up and there are arrears and there are no disposals. But when we dispose of their matters, those people don't cry out that, my matter has been finished. So be it. Now we go to how we are going to do all this work that we are doing always, lawyers and judges, differently, more efficiently and expeditiously. And to begin that, I would like to tell you that this management is also amongst animals, birds, and insects. And for that, and to see how we manage our courts better and how it has been done in other countries better, I would like to make a presentation. If the host can share it, just give me a minute. Ruby, it's not coming. Yeah. No, it's not coming. Yeah, it opened. So friends, you can.
That's better.
Okay?
Yes, wonderful. Yes.
Very well. So now, friends, you can see that these are birds. They always fly in V formation. And you also know that one bird leads the others. After a while, the second bird will take the place of the first bird and lead the others. This is their management to go home at sunset. And then there are the penguins. They live in that huge cold expanse. They huddle together for warmth. How do they do that? They manage it because the he and the she come together and give heat to their chick. Now this is a lovely example of management by teamwork. The deer and the langur in a forest. The langur gives out a yell when the leopard comes and the deer starts running. If they both are not synchronized, the deer would die. Then is the bee, and we know how it has got a structured lifestyle and how much honey it produces. Scientists have said that if everything goes off from the earth, it will take 100 years to rejuvenate. But if bees go out from this earth, within 20 years, humanity will be wiped off. That is the importance of bees and how they manage their lifestyle. And these are the eagle. They hunt in pairs. They have very good eyesight. They see the fish from high above in the sky and they swoop down and take their prey. And you know the ants, how well they manage their work in the summer to eat in the winter. And this is the cheetah who teaches its cub how to hunt, how to kill, and what to eat. And whales travel over long distances. They are an art of communication. These are, of course, little monkeys at fun, which we all want. And then come the hyenas, last of all. They don't have any management. They just take up the leftovers of the lion. And all this involves teamwork. And what is team? Together, each achieves more. So we humans, and especially we in our justice system, we as lawyers and judges must work as a team if we want our courts to be well managed and if we want to improve our image internationally. So now we consider what is management. It is not in any law books. It is not in any textbooks. I will be giving you some of the business principles of management and see how they can be applied to our work in the court. Now, the main elements of management, as Peter Drucker had said, this is for all the business school graduates. These are 5 stages: planning, organizing, directing, coordinating, and controlling. No matter what you do and no matter what your management activity is, these 5 steps are always involved and no other step is ever involved. So whether you have to manage the country of the size of India or whether you have to write a letter to a friend, you require all these 5 points and no more. You have to first plan how to write your letter. Then you have to organize your thoughts and keep them in order. Then you have to direct your steno to take it down. Then you have to coordinate with her to see whether it is done and whether you have corrected and the corrected draft is ready. And then you have to control and see that the addressee receives the letter. All this will be involved in every single management activity. It is involved in our filing of cases and our arguments of cases and our giving of judgments and all of these aspects. So now, what is case management? Lord Wolfe in England started what is called today's case management. That was in 1996 when he gave the interim report, and thereafter his final report came out. We'll just go to some of the salient features of his work. But in short, what is this case management that we always talk about but don't understand and don't do? It is practitioners and judges becoming better at what they do. So they do what they are doing, but they do it better. And therefore, he says, it is achieving the same end with less resources and in less time. Now, therefore, what is case management for? What are its benefits? It is for improving efficiency, for reducing delays, and for cutting costs. And I think if these 3 things are done, we'll not need anything else to come out with flying colors. So now the ambit of case management. Cases are procedural and substantive. They have this case management aspect of these two types, and that requires infrastructure and sensitivity. Now, infrastructure, we may be lacking. We are, I would say, somewhat in the middle. There are the Western countries who have a very strong infrastructure for criminal cases, for civil cases, for recording of evidence, and for everything. We have, but much less. But there are a vast number of countries that don't have as much as we have also, and their areas are much less than what we have also. Now, even if we don't have infrastructure, we can have sensitivity. All lawyers and judges can have sensitivity. They have to be sensitive to the fact that we are working for our clients, we are working for the litigants, we are working for our criminal justice system, and ultimately for our country. So if we are not going to work well, you are anti-nationals, I would say. You work against your nation. Now, to work for this management, there are several business principles that we can apply in our work. And each of these, I can explain to you by way of stories, and I think and I hope you will never forget. Non-value-added items. It is a very strong management principle. I would always put it first of all the management principles. It's called the principle of the big rocks. Now, how do you explain this big rocks in everyone's work? In everyone's business. In a business school, a professor comes to court, to the class. He comes with a pitcher, some stones, some pebbles, gravel, sand, a pitcher of water, and a big tumbler. So all his students look at him with some surprise. And the professor starts putting the big rocks in the pitcher first. Then he asks his students, is the pitcher full? And the students look at the pitcher and say, yes, sir, it is full. So the professor smiles and says, just look. And he puts the smaller rocks alongside the bigger rocks. And then he looks at the students, he picks up some gravel and puts the gravel around the smaller rocks. Then he throws in some sand, shakes up the pitcher, and again asks his students, now is the pitcher full? And the students say, yes, sir, now it is definitely full. So again, the professor smiles and he says, just look at what I'm doing. And he pours the jar of water into the pitcher until it comes to the brim. And then he asks his students, what is the moral of this story? And the students, the business students that they are, as smart as the lawyers, they say, oh, sir, if there is time and space to do always some more. So the professor says, yes, this is a very good principle, but it is not the moral of this story. The moral of this story is that if you don't put in your big rocks in the pitcher first, as I have done, you will never be able to put them in ever at all. So he tells his students, now you visualize. If you put your sand and gravel first, and then the stones, and then the bigger stones, will they ever fit? And the students understand what the teacher is saying. And then the professor says, now therefore, as business magnates of tomorrow, every day when you get up in the morning, ask yourself, what are my big rocks for today? And put them in your day first. You will always be able to put in the smaller rocks at some time or the other during the rest of the day. Now, let us see how lawyers and judges can apply this principle and how well it fits into our work. We have what are called parterre matters, high on board matters, first on board matters, only matters, whatever, whatever. Those are the matters that have to be taken up first. They are the big rocks of our court. Similarly, for lawyers, you will be having several suits and several matters and criminal appeals and everything on your boards on one day. But you know that this particular matter is an urgent matter. That particular matter is a very good matter. This is another matter where your client is very much interested and bothering you all the time. you will know which is that big rock. And you should be able to put that rock in your day first, because the other rocks will take care of themselves. Then we go to the next principle, the principle of core competence. Everywhere in business, we have core competence. The production manager will not know what is the work of the sales manager. And the human rights, the human resources people will not know what is done by the finance department. But here amongst lawyers and judges, we want to know everything which we never do. We should be specialist judges, as Lord Justice Wolfe said in his report. Every judge and every lawyer must have some edge. And to have that edge, you have to be a specialist in a particular line of law, because no one knows everything. Similarly, we have what are now called court managers. They are the business managers who have come into our system, but we give them hardly any heed or attention. They are the persons who are going to administer the courts, and the judges and lawyers must do only the work that they are well suited for. So that is their core competence, and we must not waste our time over things which are not our core competence. Then comes time management. The 80-20 rule, as they say. 80% of the people do 20% of the work, and 20% of the people do 80% of the work in every profession and even amongst lawyers. But there should always be a time frame. Now, time management is such a concept that it will take up one entire 67th webinar, I suppose. But I won't go into it in the 66th webinar. Then there is the principle of procedural simplification. It is something we need the most and lack the most. Our civil procedure code has got some very salutary provisions which we never use. And it has got some provisions which have landed us into so much trouble which we every day use. We must know what to use and what not to use and how to simplify all those rules. When Thomas Alva Edison was working at his inventions, he wanted some scientists. He hired a young scientist. So this gentleman comes in and says, okay, I'll have to be working here, but sir, what are the rules in your organization? And Edison tells him, son, here we are working to achieve something. We got no rules here. Now for this simplification, I will tell you a story which is told in all business schools. That is called the moon story. When the Americans went to the moon in 1969, they realized that a ball pen doesn't work in space. So when they came back, they reported it, and the American government set aside $250 million to research on what kind of pen will work in space. They did not see that the Russians had gone in space earlier. Yuri Gagarin had gone there in 1957. Laika, the dog, had also gone earlier, but of course without any pen. But Yuri Gagarin had used a pencil. There was no need for any research for any pen. Then comes a very important business principle called paradigm shift. Now, every work and every profession has a paradigm. I presume you know what a paradigm is. It is the ambit of the work, the main basis of the work that you do. In business, we have what is called CBI. That is creative business ideas, not Central Bank of India also. And not Central Bureau of Investigation also. Creative business ideas. So with a paradigm shift, if you work, then you find that you're working in a completely different atmosphere. And therefore, all the bad points and the demerits of your system are all gone. Now, I'll give you two stories for that. One is the sitar story. There was once a sitarist. He practiced his sitar and he had to show it to his guru. So he played the sitar and his guru was not happy. He played again and again, but the guru was not happy. He said, now I'll play one last time, otherwise I'll give it up. He did it. But the guruji said that he was not perfect. So he said, I've done my very best and it appears that I'm not going to be a sitarist. I give up. Just then, the Guruji said, take out your sitar from your right hand, put it in your left hand, and try all over again. And he became a very famous sitarist. Similarly, there is a story of the Swiss watch. Now, we all know that Swiss make the best watches in the world, Rolex, Omega, and call it what you want. One Swiss man invented a non-winding watch. Now, all this Rolex, Omega, and all the clocks are winding watches. So the Swiss people laughed at him and said, we are the world's best watchmakers. And how can any good watch work without winding? This Swiss man sold his idea to a Japanese. That was the quartz watch. And today we all wear quartz watches. Do we have time to wind our watches every morning today? We don't. These are paradigm shifts. Similarly, when you have to get a result, you have to shift the paradigm to achieve that result. Of course, provided it is legal. Now, there's a story of a king and his painter. This painter was working with his son in the court of the king. And the king told the painter that this is a vase and I want you to paint it exactly the color of my bedroom. The father and son duo tried and tried, but did not get the very exact color. Because the color on a glass and a color on a wall would naturally, even if it's the same color, look different because of various physical principles. But the king wanted it, so they were scared that they would be beheaded. Now they worked and worked, and the son was very tired and he goes to sleep. He gets up in the morning and he sees that the wall is exactly the color of the glass. So he says, oh, father, you did it. How did you do it? And his father says, I painted the wall. Now, this was a paradigm shift. He achieved the same result. He got both the colors exactly the same, but he could not do it on glass. He did it on concrete. Then is the principle of decentralization, a very simple principle which is followed in every corporate endeavor. Now, for example, for service in our system, how do we have this principle? We can have it in many ways. But service, for example, I have attended so many workshops on case management and on reduction of delays and errors, etc. And every time there are people who come up with some great ideas about how to improve efficiency of service, when I think that there is no need at all. When I was a principal judge of the family court, that was way back in 2004, I realized that there were about 10,000 petitions and there were 8 bailiffs and services were not done for 2 or 3 months at a stretch. So I decentralized that process. I took out all of those bailiffs. And I said that every single lawyer is himself going to serve, if he is the lawyer of the petitioner, taking the writ from the court and making it returnable at his own address. 80% of the respondents came to my court on the very first day of hearing. 20% did not come. And for about 10% of them, I again ordered the service through the lawyer, but by another mode. I said, you do it by registered post, etc., etc. Only in 10% of the cases, I had to call upon my bailiff to do it. And I realized that bailiffs did a very good job because they had only 10% of the matters with them and the corruption had come down absolutely. Similarly, we have various decentralizing agencies now. We have law clerks, for example. You have interns and assistants. It is always good to decentralize. Don't keep everything in your hand because you're not going to be able to do it. Remember, once you were a junior, and tomorrow your junior is going to be a senior. Now, the next principle is of latest first, an extremely important principle. Nobody follows in our system, not even the Supreme Court. What we do is we've got so much of arrears, so the Supreme Court said, finish off the 10 years arrears cases first. So we all started working on the 10 years cases. and we did finish off so many of them. In the meantime, thousands of cases became 1, 2, 3 years old, and we never could take them. Now we had arrears of 5 years cases. So the Supreme Court says, well, dispose of 5 years arrears first. And this goes on with the result that new cases become old. Now, every lawyer would want at least certain of his clients to get relief first, to get relief quickly. At least some of the clients have a very good case and they must get the relief quickly, even if the other clients on the other side want to delay. So what do you do? What we must do is take up the last cases first. Because if we don't do that, then the old cases, the new cases will become old, and it is always working wills within wills. So what we say is these frivolous suits, which take up a lot of time because somebody wants injunction and files a frivolous suit or takes up false defenses. If that suit can reach hearing within, say, 3 months, 4 months, 8 months, they will not file frivolous suits. They will not take up false defenses. Even in a suit which is filed, they will want mediation. They will want to settle. They will say there is no use delaying the matter. But if you are going to give them the time, they are going to take the time. So this is like the snake story, a very interesting story. Now, when the British were in India, they were very scared of snakes. So one British officer said that he has instituted an award for every snake which is killed. And so many people killed snakes and collected the award. Now, many snakes were killed, but the snakes were still there. And the British were just as scared as they were earlier. They realized that the people are rearing the snakes to kill them to take the award. So the British officer stopped the award. And there were as many snakes as there were before. This is because the latest first did not come in. And they went round in circles, wheels within wheels. Then is the principle of sharing best practices. This is, as you know, shared everywhere. Today in this webinar, we are sharing our best practices. You can come up with suggestions and comments, and I would take them home. I can give you some of my suggestions in this presentation. You can take them home. We do that all the time in our workshops, in our judicial academies, for example, with the judges. Everywhere, it is good to share best practices. It is not good to only hear a lecture by somebody, but to actually come together and interact so that each one brainstorms. Ruby? Going ahead. Sorry. Then there's a, can you, I hope you can hear me because I can't hear you.
Yeah, perfectly.
All right. Systemic challenges.
Can't hear.
Now, this is also in every business endeavor, in every single activity. There are three circles. The smallest circle is the circle of control. That is where we can control everything. A judge can control the demeanor in his court, for example. A lawyer can control what his client would present to the court. It's a very small circle. Around that circle is the circle of influence. It is not the influence to corrupt anybody. I'm not talking about that influence. It is the influence which everyone can exercise. A lawyer by his advocacy, for example, a judge by his innovative judgment. So that is a little larger circle. And the largest circle is the circle of concern. That is the circle where we all lack. That is the circle which we must really improve upon. Because there is a concern. There's a concern that there are 3 crore cases in our court. There is concern that so many judges don't take up certain matters. There is concern that all the matters are being adjourned. And there's something each one cannot do, but we all collectively can do. If we come together and really work for our system and for our country, then alone this circle of concern will become smaller. Then the next principle is the single and double loop thinking. Single loop is what and double loop is how or why. So whenever we are thinking of law, for example, a client comes to us. So we say, oh, this section of that law is going to be applicable and I'm going to file the petition on that. It is single loop thinking. But when you sit down with your client, and when you find out why the client wants it, how it can be achieved in the best possible way, which are the other modes in which you can achieve the same result, for example, ADR or any such thing, that would be double loop thinking. That would give you the results quicker, more efficiently, and more expeditiously. And that is the principle of goal versus task. You have to change your task to reach your goal. This is just like the painter and the singer story, which I told you. The next principle is of performance-related promotions and payments. Now, you see, there are several lawyers who can really deliver the goods, and therefore they are paid more. They are paid more, and therefore they think that they can really deliver the goods, but sometimes they cannot. But when they have got their juniors, it is the performance from which they would get their promotions. So this PRP thing, performance-related promotions and payments, is important everywhere. And that, of course, you lawyers know better than I do. The next thing is the judicial social service. Now there is corporate social responsibility. We also have judicial social responsibility, but we somehow don't have lawyer social responsibility, except for legal aid, where some of the lawyers give their services, but the best of the lawyers don't. And if one lawyer, each lawyer can give even one day, one matter in a year, you can imagine how many matters can be disposed of quicker and how many other people can get their services. And they would always be known. That would be the lawyer social services. There are, of course, some lawyers who have dedicated their lives to social law, like the IJM or things like that. And throughout their lives, they render social service. But they are a class apart. Then there is continuous education in every single endeavor, also in law and justice. We have continuous education in our judicial academies for judges. You must have continuous education the way you are having in these webinars, thanks to Corona. In the US, there is this National Center for State Courts, which continuously works. It's a whole institution. Every day it works with lawyers. And there's a lot of interaction for continuous education where the laws are discussed. And last is what I told you right in the beginning, team. Together, each achieves more. That is the leadership training. And lawyers and judges are two sides of the same coin. As Justice Krishna Iyer had said, it is the vision, the mission, and the passion of the bar and the bench that makes the whole difference. Now, these are the business principles that I have culled out for lawyers and judges in their work. Now, how do we apply it in our case management, in our actual day-to-day work? Now, if we see the stages of our cases, more especially an entire civil suit, because that consists of everything, the entire trial. So I'll take you to the suit first. Plaint. It should be brief, concise, and precise. I don't know from various jurisdictions that you all come, but I come from Bombay, and the lengthiest of the plaints in the country are from Bombay. The Supreme Court judges have said, this matter must have come from Bombay, it appears. There was a story. Now that kind of a plaint, no matter what English it has, is no good. Judges don't read it. And because we don't, we told them in about 1990s, late 90s, that we want a synopsis of every single plaint and petition. The synopsis was so long, not brief, concise, and precise, as the Civil Procedure Code says, that we then had to tell them, now give us only a chronology of events and dates. And we read nothing more, because there's nothing more to read, except after a trial when we read everything cover to cover. Now, after the plaint is filed, the first step is the service. And as I told you, simplification, decentralization are the management principles applicable. You can serve in any which way you want. Email and even WhatsApp is what the Supreme Court has said. It can be the service mode. Interim applications. I think Bombay takes the cake in interim applications, but everywhere there would be interim applications for most of the matters. This is the stage when the lawyer as well as the judge, when he hears the matter, knows the case threadbare. It is a new case. The client has recently come. All the documents are in place. The client is also well and fit and fine. And the lawyer has argued, the judge has heard. An ad interim application can itself be made an interim application, and an interim order can be passed. When the interim application is heard after all the affidavits, everything comes on record. Whether you call it a written statement or a reply or a counter or whatever name called, an interim application's reply brings in the defense of the defendant. Now, if you can treat that as the written statement, as it is called in the CPC, both the pleadings are before you, before the judge, and issues can be framed there and then, because the judge has heard threadbare everything and the lawyers know threadbare everything. Even if some of the issues are left out, issues can always be modified, amended, added to, deleted under Order 14, Rule 4. So interim application is the most sacrosanct application, so that the interim stage ends and the real trial begins with the framing of issues on the same day as the order is passed. Then accordingly goes the ad interim relief. Then there are the returnable dates. Now the computer gives returnable dates. We thought that we are going to have a computerized system, the CMS as it is called. It is a complete failure. The computer gives dates after about a month or two. No lawyer wants these dates. Therefore, each lawyer comes to the court to get a date. And therefore, even in the high court, judges have to spend half an hour to 1 hour giving dates. It is an atrocious, scandalous aspect. When I was a judge, about half an hour was taken up when I used to sit on a division bench with somebody. And when I was a single judge, I never did that work. Everything was done by my legal associate who would give the date. I said, give whichever date the lawyer wants. We are duty bound to work. So if the lawyer says work tomorrow, keep it. We will work tomorrow. And all that time was saved for the returnable date. Now, the rejection of the plaint, only in some of the matters, but a very salutary provision, Order 7, Rule 11, which is a weeding requirement. So only when the jurisdiction aspect, the bar created by a law of what fees aspect takes place, these suits can be weeded out. If the suits are not weeded out, if the issues are framed, the trial begins, the affidavit of evidence is filed, then what is the next best step? Under Order 18, Rule 4, the courts have been allowed to, I would say, outsource only one kind of work, and that is the recording of evidence. So we must appoint court commissioners when this facility is given to us right from 1999, and thereafter confirmed in 2002 in the Salem Bar case, court commissioners would record the evidence. Now, whilst that is being recorded, it is recorded in question-answer form. I have never understood why, because there is no bar to recording evidence in a narrative. But it is a recorded question and answer wise, and the lawyers raise objections to every question almost. So the objection is recorded. By the time the answer has to be given, either the witness is completely perplexed or the witness really makes up his answer. In either case, justice is not done. So this kind of a system of court commissioners is not working well, but it can be polished. It is not the reason not to have it. You have to have it and polish it. You can say question, then answer, and then objection, if any, just for the sake of record. Because the commissioner cannot, of course, say that he will uphold the objection and not record the question. The next is oral applications. Day by day, all oral applications which were made earlier are now converted into written applications, which is not a healthy practice. There are several things which can be done orally because we are lawyers and judges, and we have to have that kind of character that people understand that we are going to abide by. And therefore, oral applications can dispose of some of the things. That is how we have come to the stage of disposal of the suit. So we record cross-examination and dispose of the suit. Earlier to that is the written statement, which step I missed, because in the interim stage, I told you that any affidavit or anything that comes can be treated as a written statement. If there is no interim application, then you would have a written statement after the pleadings are filed. And as we were discussing right in the beginning today, how many days, etc., etc., we have to endeavor to do it in a week's time. We can do it in many matters. We may not be able to do it in some matters. More time can be granted. But we have taken so much time that now the legislature has taken away that discretion. And therefore, if there is no written statement, there will be an ex parte decree. Some say that it will be unjust, but there is a very strong feeling amongst non-lawyers, but very, very logical, intelligent non-lawyer persons who say that even if 5% of the matters are disposed of that way without a written statement, people will be so prompt that thereafter 95% of the cases will be disposed of with written statement and quickly. Then comes the small aspect of original documents. Now there are many documents, Xerox copies of which are produced, computer sheets of which are produced, etc. Now, if there are original documents which are brought to court when there is a physical copy, then inspection can be taken in the court itself in so many of the matters. The judge can see it right at that time. I used to put a caption on my board that I will not grant any ad interim relief without original documents. So if somebody doesn't come, I say, sorry, I will not grant it. You come back with your documents. And the documents, once they come, the other party can easily see them. So the entire inspection aspect is sometimes wiped off. Then is a preliminary decree, a provision which we always miss out under Order 20, Rule 18, and other rules, partnership suits, administration suits, suits for accounts, etc., can be disposed of by a preliminary decree earlier, and then you have to go to the next best stage. Now, what is that next best stage? Under the law, it is that you go to the commissioner for recording evidence. But no, that is not the next best stage. That is the next stage. The next best then, once the preliminary decree is passed and the shares are determined, you go to ADR. You go to mediation, and the entire suit, an administration suit, partition suit, all of those things which are generally within the family or within business families can be disposed of quicker by the mode of mediation, which is the really alternative dispute resolution. Then an importance on admissions. Admitted facts don't have to be proved. But we have so many lawyers who put up all those admitted facts in their evidence, which is not required. And therefore, we understand that this is something which has to go by the board. It is a non-value added item. It must be just recorded so that the issues then can be narrowed. So then after admission recording is the stage of issues, which in an interim application, I told you, we can do both of these things. When the interim application itself is disposed of, the judge can record the admissions and narrow down the issues and frame those issues. Then, of course, comes the evidence, which is the cross-examination, which can be recorded by the court commissioner, and the judge has to read it at home, and the advocates would have to show the relevant parts. Then is the compilation of all these documents, and then comes the stage of arguments. Arguments can be oral or in writing, not oral and in writing. So it depends, whatever the lawyers may want, either long arguments with bullet points, or long written arguments with only small clarifications would be ideal. And that is followed by judgment, which judges must give within the period specified, the highest of which is 60 days. Now, judgment on arguments in some matters, especially in the Commercial Courts Act, under the Commercial Courts Act, and for this commercial matters, is very essential. And that is the principle we have picked up from America, where they were giving summary judgments. So if a judgment can be given without cross-examination, either party can apply. And there are many matters under the commercial jurisprudence. Now that I do arbitrations, I find many of the arbitrations where judgment can be given on arguments and there is no need for recording evidence. In, of course, arbitration, we lay down our own procedure and therefore it works better. Costs is a very important concept. The higher the cost, the greater the deterrence to delaying tactics. And therefore that must be granted to a litigant who has suffered. ADR is excellent in our system. Arbitration and conciliation under that act, mediation and Lok Nyayalay under and after the litigation. Summary suits is where within 10 days the defense has to be brought in and otherwise the suit is declared ex parte. It is something like the Portuguese Procedure Code, which was for all the civil suits. Now, all these are the stages which will result in better case management if they are more polished with all these business principles which I told you. Now, in UK, how do they have this case management? The aspects under the Lord Wolf report are all of these. The length of time for every litigation. They say for every fast track, it will be 13 weeks and no more. Fast track and multi-track are the two types. Everything goes in fast track except for medical negligence cases and other very, very big cases where a lot of evidence of experts is involved. Then there is a fixed timetable given by the court. Inspection is controlled by getting the original documents and showing them in the court itself. Exchanging of witness statements is what we do by way of affidavit of evidence after this Lord Wolf report. Video recording, as we also have in some of the cases, especially the criminal cases. And the summary procedure in several suits below £10,000. Then the aspects under this report are for defining important issues. So they have, now we have got what is called preliminary issue and final issue. They have important issue. So if there is one important issue and that is decided, all the other issues fall in place. Then there's a timetable deadline. ADR is very well used. The judicial team consists of training judges and lawyers together. So they are trained, they discuss out things together. They don't blame one another, but they work as a team. Interest and costs, as I told you, in England now there is capping of costs because the cost used to be very, very severe. IT kiosks, or may I help you, desks are in all the courts. Permanent advice centers is like, may I help you? And evening and weekend courts always work in England. Now the areas of case management in England, length of time, key issues, listing of cases is also considered very important. Pre-trial conference is what we have picked up from the American jurisprudence. It is now in the Commercial Causes Act. The Commercial Times Act, and setting a timetable deadline, which is for the preliminary hearing. So, for the Lord Wolf report, the basic features are the procedural simplicity and the control by judges. And what is peculiar to England are the costs, the expert witnesses, and unlimited legal aid. Any single person in the country can ask for legal aid from the best of lawyers. Then the Lord Wolf report, how it can be made applicable to India, I have just given you separately. Each one of us can think it differently. The simplest rules, the rules are made simplified. We have got amendment to the CPC and the High Court rules. The defense, there is only one, something called a defense. Here we have written statement. It can be also affidavit in reply, which is a written statement, because that is a statement on oath in any case. Then there is exchanging witness statements, which we have by way of affidavit of examination in chief. Small claims, and we have summary suits. Specialist judges, We have civil and criminal judges, but generally our judges do both the work. There should be specialist judges. We have judges on the original side and appellate side. What is important is a package deal. Now, this package deal for lawyers and judges is what? A lawyer can say that I will charge this much for giving you the last relief just now. Every client will want it. It is like a tourist trade, I would say. Earlier, the tour agents would book our tickets only, the flight tickets. Then they started booking our flight tickets and hotels, so we tell them to do that. Then they book the flight tickets, hotels, and the entire tours for sightseeing, so we tell them to do that. Now, that is a package deal. And the tour operator earns threefold, and we don't mind it because our time is saved. So if litigants can pay the lawyers for not delivering the goods, why will they not pay the lawyers for delivering the goods? Then there is this fixed fee in England, and we have ADR. We have ADR in England as well as in India. And the capping of costs in England and imposing realistic costs in India. Now, this court management strategy, I would say, how it is to be worked out in courts. The lawyers can ask for, and the judges can dispose of and complete all the proceedings between the same parties. So when parties are represented, all are heard on merits. If there are two or three matters, whichever judge takes up that one matter which is being heard can call for the other matters and dispose of everything together. It results in very good ADR, because then parties sit down together even to mediate very well. The second strategy is to complete the main proceeding first, that is the big rocks. So you complete the main proceeding, even at the admission stage, take up the thing for final hearing, if as far as it can be taken up, and I'm sure it can be taken up in many, many matters, I did that, and hear both parties on merits at one time. Now, there was this Lord Norman Macleod, who was the Chief Justice in the Bombay High Court between 1919 and 1926. And what he used to do is, when the parties filed their pleadings, he used to just ask them, do you say on oath that everything is correct? And the plaintiff says yes, and the defendant says yes. And he used to say, okay, you cross-examine both of them. And that, it appears, worked very well in that court. I don't see how it cannot work now. We do that in arbitrations. I tell in my arbitrations that everything is on record. There is no need to file an affidavit of evidence also. If there is anything further, you may file. But by all means, cross-examine on the claim and the defense. This completes the case management, the management of the cases with us. Then there is something like taking all the cases together, and that is called court management. Now that, of course, lawyers may not be much concerned with, but some of the matters would be even available to lawyers for concern. And that is scrutiny of the matters, which we do regularly. Technicalities which lawyers and judges should really eschew. It's okay, you have to just do justice to your client and to the other side, and the judge has to do justice to both the parties. Technicalities apart. They are the non-value-added items. Then comes the directions. I told you oral orders, etc. Oral applications can be made and orders can be passed by way of directions so that the suit comes up for hearing soon. Once the judgment is delivered, the certified copies must be given on the same day. Unfortunately, it has not been done, though we have got computerization from 1999. It used to take 3 months, then it took 2 months, now it takes 15 days. But I don't see why it should take 15 days. If urgent orders can be given the same day, why not all orders? Only thing is that it should be decentralized in every court so that the steno of that judge only can take up all those matters. Then there are group matters. As I told you, the CM strategy. The group matters can be taken up in a group by a single judge who gets the matter first. New suits could be taken up first, and one judge can be assigned for new suits so that the new suits don't become old suits. The case tracking is like case computerization. I won't go into that now. Then expedition orders not to appease the parties, but when the case is on merits exceedingly good for one of the parties, that is the case to be expedited. Then we can have bench books and handbooks for all courts, so that there are nice small booklets which gives out what this court, the usually reported judgments, etc., can be at one place, and the officer can show the court. The propositions of law is like what they have in America. This is the proposition of law. Thereafter, no judgments, no precedents are taken. It is a proposition of law. For example, the documents have to be read as a whole. It is such a sound proposition of law, we don't require judgments to be shown to any judge for that. Then teaching the basic law in schools and colleges is, I think, exceedingly important for to be lawyers. Then discharge of suits on boards. Now boards are computerized and you can discharge them. I have come to learn that there's a very sound practice in Kerala where only two suits are kept on boards. Now that would mean that the rest of the suits which would have come up on that day, that board is discharged by itself. So on the website also it can be discharged, and parties don't come to court and crowd the courts. The assignment period and the part heard matters can be taken up first, because that is sort of, you know, the important matters, those two matters, the big rocks. Classification of suits is very important to be done by the principal judge or the chief judge. And pursuant to that classification, suits have to be heard in bulk at times when there are many suits of the same type or petitions. The registrar's powers can be increased. Then there is a facilitation counter. So the facilitation counter is a "may I help you" desk, and that guides the parties in court. Flexi vacations is a very sound idea. I don't know how many of you would like it, but each one goes on vacation. Each judge goes on vacation at his own time, because everyone, of course, needs a vacation. And the courts go on forever. So judges come and judges go, but courts go on forever. Lawyers come and lawyers go, and courts must go on forever. Now the US practice, very sound US case management practice, is restatement of the law. Every 10 to 15 years on every topic, there are the statements made, and then those laws need not be cited. Cases need not be cited. And then there is this rocket, which is the fast track, so that the frivolous cases through discovery are disposed of quicker. Now the computerized systems. There is a Red Crest electronic case management system in Australia. In Singapore, now they are having the integrated electronic litigation system. So what court management system that we have is now replaced in Australia and Singapore, but we are still working with our rudimentary system, and I hope it works well. Now the systemic problem solving. We've got so many problems with this court and case management which we don't do and we mismanage. We have to identify the problems, make plans for improvement, apply those improvement techniques, and put the plan into practice. Now for that also, I'll give you one very strange but very nice example, which is called the Japanese way of fishing. The Japanese like fresh fish. They've got a lot of ocean and they've got a lot of fish. But the demand for fish is so great that all the time the supply becomes less and less. So the fishermen go out far into the sea to get more and more fish. But the Japanese don't like it, because the fishermen come late and the fish are stale. So the fishermen, they took freezers into the ocean. And they took their trawlers deep into the ocean, and they collected a lot of fish, and they froze them and brought them to sell. But the Japanese were not happy, because the fish tasted stale. So then what did the fishermen do? They took a water tank instead of a freezer, and they went fishing into the ocean. And when they caught the fish, they put the fish into the tank. So the fish kept on being alive until it came to the shore. But that fish was not active. And the Japanese did not like the taste of that fish. So then what did the fishermen do? They took bigger tanks. They collected the fish in water tanks, but they put a small shark in the tank. So the fish went on swimming round and round into the tank until it came to the shore. And the fish were very active, and the Japanese were happy because they found the flesh very fresh. So that is how you solve the problem. It is a kind of paradigm shift. Now, the five issues of case management: the role and responsibility of judges, knowledge of law, the method of judging, the management in that method, and the organizational efficiency. That is what gives the edge. The approach to time management: you have to aim, prioritize, plan, execute, and monitor. It is something like the first five principles which I told you. Now, in India, there are these management systems: the national court management at the macro level and the state court management at micro level. But yet we require judicial reforms. And though this may not come of use at present, some of them are already in vogue, being used. So you might just go through them. The national litigation policy, national framework of court excellence, system of performance parameters, court development planning system, increased strength of judges, including ad hoc judges. And for ad hoc judges, lawyers can be appointed judges for a couple of years and they can practice in the same court, which is a very good principle which we don't follow. If that is so, the best of lawyers would become judges for 2 years and then they can practice there. National pool for retired judges, because retired judges are not tired judges. They are still working judges. Speedy appointment of judges, raise retirement age of judges, not 62. When Justice Kirby had come to India and he came to know our retirement age, it was 58 for the district judges, plus 260, 62 for High Court judges, 65 for Supreme Court, I told him. And he said, I'm 59 and I'm just beginning to be good. They retire at 75. And then the increased number of working days, which we are getting from time to time, and flexi vacations, which I already told you. The legal and judicial reforms are for whatever actually, which I have already told you, the various things which would come up in reforms, and the removal of roadblocks. Pleadings as evidence, not treating pleadings as evidence is a roadblock. Evidence of all witnesses together one by one at one time, day to day, is not done, which is a roadblock. Simplification of proof of documents. Old documents, documents in a group can be always taken in together. Though the Evidence Act strictly does not permit it. We do that in our arbitrations. Amendment of statutes sometimes is required. Sections 80, 164 of the Municipal Corporation Act, etc., etc., can be done away with. They are really archaic. Updation of court fees is a must, because if we are going to give expeditious remedies, the litigants must pay those kind of court fees so that the lawyers get and the system gets. Now, these are some of the CPC amendments of 2016 after the Commercial Causes Act came into force, and they are in itself a case management thing. I have just recorded them for your information if you want. And all of these things can be done in these five stages. Amendment of orders of the CPC, the High Court can do. High Court practice directions can be issued for all of these things which I said. Judicial training and lawyers training. Precedence, because there are some judgments which are actually for case management. And court administration, which is left to the judges. If all that is done, I would say, if it is to be, it is up to me, up to each one of us to constitute our system. And as they said, I can do what you cannot do, and you can do what I cannot do, but together we can do great things. Thank you. Ruby?
That was a wonderful express presentation, I would say. To be very frank with you, we thought some magic will happen and everything will happen, or it will just work out on its own. Never thought of a structured or a scientific approach to these sort of things. But ma'am, after hearing you, I think it's high time we identified our big rocks and arranged it properly. May I request Ramkumar sir for the comments?
Madam, wonderful presentation. In fact, thank you for the systems approach to cases given in a capsule form. Beautiful presentation. And I have one suggestion. We can put it to all. What is your opinion about live streaming of courts and having a connectivity with the High Court? All courts should be have live streaming so that the High Court and at every level, even district courts, can find out who is responsible for delaying the cases, for delay, whether it is the judge or the lawyer or somebody else or the client, etc. So that the system should go on without any interruption. And that flexi vacations is a beautiful idea. Even lawyer's office can think of such flexi vacations. Some few juniors can be given vacation while the other juniors can work, so that judges and lawyers can have flexi vacations, where the system will have an uninterrupted service to the humanity. And I find that much of the judges' work time is wasted on pre-trial steps. As you said, rightly said, the registrars can be given more powers. We can have qualified and experienced registrars and sharadars in the lower court who can deal with all these pre-trial steps, so that the judge need devote his attention only to the trial work for which alone he is qualified, he is trained.
Absolutely.
And I found one motto: think globally and act locally. I think Justice Mishra fell into disrepute by quoting this. And that other idea also, take up the last case first. That is, new suits can be taken, otherwise new suits will become old. It's like eating fresh fruits, always fresh, instead of always eating stale fruits. Good idea. Thank you, madam. Wonderful lecture. In fact, I initially thought that what is the use in hearing such a lecture, especially for a retired judge like me. It was really wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramkumar sir. Over to you, Justice Ramakrishnan sir.
Really a good lecture on case management as well as court management from a retired judge, a high court judge, not only having high court experience, but also on the lower court side also. See, madam, I say you are comparing the foreign system with here. Even in our place, the whole difficulty is, even in a bank case where loan is admitted, they won't admit the loan. They will deny the execution, they will deny the process, etc., etc. Thereby, you are compelled to frame a charge, the issues, and thereafter post for trial. So, if the people can, see, first of all, the mental setup of the people will not be changed, for which the lawyers will not be trained. Tell them that there is no meaning in asking for contesting the cases, except that you ask for some time, court may grant time. See, in such cases, the easy cases where on admission where no real issues are there, then on the basis of the admission or on the basis of the, though there is a provision in the CPC while framing issues, if the admitted facts, even a partial decree can be passed. I do not know how many courts are following that. So those are all the areas. It depends upon the mindset of the people also, because they will have to, where the foreign courts, you are only taking valid defenses. Transactions are not denied unless there is a real dispute regarding the transaction itself. So such things also causes, according to me, some delay in the process of delivering justice system here. And also in foreign countries, ADR system is being adopted as part of the judicial system. As a judge, you know how many of us, even among judges, there is a feeling that ADR is a failure, is an unnecessary thing. And the lawyers also having a feeling that the sending matters for ADR is a deterioration in the judicial justice delivery system that will affect the quality of the court system. So these are all the areas where the mindset of the people also will have to change. Once that is changed, all your, what do you call, the streamlined method by which the court manage can be done, will be easier. Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir.
Yes. Anyhow, the presentation is very good, madam. It is really helpful also for the purpose of framing the mind of the judge or a lawyer as how you will have to be prepared for taking the case and dispose of the case. Thank you very much, madam.
Okay, if there are questions or suggestions, I am prepared to take them. Otherwise, can we call it a day?
Shyam or Pradeep?
I think he's not here. I think he may he was traveling. So, anybody? Any questions? Anybody?
You can.
Premraj. Premraj.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hello, madam.
Wait. One by one. Monitor, you ask first.
Okay. As Ram Kumar sir has suggested, there a system is already in force. So, not effectively.
You are not audible.
Not audible. Am I audible now?
Very weak.
No, then somebody else may take my stand. I will come back after correcting it.
Okay. So the next person.
Madam, namaskar. This is Jagannath Kulkarni. I am a first year law student. And I want to request you to share this presentation if possible, number one. And second is, what advice would you like to give for the aspiring advocates? Thank you, madam.
I think my entire lecture was an advice. You must understand.
For the aspiring or budding advocates or those who wishes to pursue the profession of advocacy and the students like me, I am a first year student. Please, madam.
See, whatever you do with an edge. You know, you try to do things better. When you go to your senior's office, you see how better you can do anything. And it will all fall in place. And I personally have always believed that this business principle help us in our work. That is for the efficiency. That is for the experience. As students, of course, you have to understand the law, study the law, look up the judgments, and do all that we all have done in the substantive law aspect. I wish you all the best.
So, yes, thank you
very much.
You can take the presentation because I have put it on this system. So it can be shared.
Manoj, do you have a question, Manoj? I think nobody is having any.
Hello. Hello.
Okay. You ask. Do you have a question?
Yeah. May I ask?
Sure. Just put your question. It's
some disturbances, sir.
Some disturbances, sir. I cannot do anything at my end.
Manoj, take peace.
Manoj, it would be better if you mute yourself. Mr. Manoj, could you just mute yourself? Okay, now it's become a bit low. You can ask your question. Vishwata, you can ask your question. You are on mute now. Just unmute. You are on mute. Okay, ask.
Yes. Disturbance is coming. No? Disturbance.
There is disturbance, but I can't do anything from my end now. So now you can ask.
Thank you, madam. Am I hearing?
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, you are audible.
Now, madam, in your lecture, you have quoted two aspects. One is I'm asking about delay. One is about delay. Is Manoj online? See, somebody has to mute to this. Somebody has to mute.
I have been sending messages, but unfortunately,
somebody has to mute. Somebody has to mute, I think. And yes, now I'm is clear, I think. Advocate Manoj has to mute, otherwise he has to speak.
You keep asking your question, please.
Yes. Madam, I want to ask on two points. That is, are you hearing?
Yes, sir.
One is about delay. In certain aspects, we found that after closing the evidence and argument, the court is posting for reservation of judgment and reservation for judgment. And as you said, there is some prescribed time is fixed for delivering judgment. But in certain cases we found inordinate delay is happened. The prescribed date will be there, but some of the courts will not deliver judgment, that will be postponed. And even there are certain cases, even after the presiding officer got transfer, he may leave without delivering judgment. Then what happens is, the new presiding officer, before new presiding officer, the advocate has to argue the case again, because that he may not be conversant with the facts of the case. And that the delay is going on. That is number one. Second, you have also mentioned regarding the delay that I want to be appointment of the judges. Their executive is responsible for that. And third one I want to mention is, wherever there is a technical problem, that means some advocates have missed to take some steps. That may be on certain technical grounds. Even the presiding officer know, if that step would have been taken, the case may be in favor of that advocate, that client. But sometimes the court may ignore it. Then without taking steps, that case will fail. So these are all certain arena where we have to think about it. What is your suggestion about that, madam?
Well, I have told you in my points for case management that judgment is one point and it must be delivered within at least 60 days. Quite often we deliver before. So if a judge has not delivered, it is really dereliction of duty. I would not at all say that judge can be spared. So far as the appointment is concerned, yes, the executive has to appoint more judges, but just appointing more judges is not the problem. Each of the judges cannot mismanage. Each of the judges will have to manage, and all the lawyers together will have to help him manage. So, yes, these are the two things I accept, and they should go.
Okay, so,
thank you.
qualified, and Monet, you can put in your
doubt. Oh, okay. Madam, it was wonderful. And I'm not asking any doubt. I'm sharing something because Ramkumar sir has suggested some methods to be adopted. I may point out that in the Salem Advocates Bar Association case, in the first case in 2002, many of the listeners may be remembering that a committee was appointed by the Apex Court, Jagannath Rao committee, headed by Justice Mr. Jagannath Rao. And a report was submitted, and that was accepted by the Apex Court. And in second Salem Bar Association case in 2005, all courts were directed to formulate case management system as a policy. The Kerala High Court also, by virtue of the powers under Section 122 of the CPC, passed the rules, Kerala Civil Court Case Flow Management Rules 2015. There, as Ramkumar sir has suggested, even powers are delegated to the court officer to process the cases which are at summon stage, at the stage of filing pleadings. That is already there. That's already there. And even the burden of the presiding officer is very much reduced to a considerable extent. And some part, up to the pleading stage, what can be done by the court officer, the bench clerks are so named as court officers in the rules. So that is already there. But the difficulty is that it is not being, the difficulty is that that is not being followed in all courts. But throughout India, that there is a direction that was enforced to frame similar rules. So this could be, this could achieve some fruitful purpose if it is done.
It should be followed everywhere. It is like the Arbitration Council, for example. Under the Arbitration Act, in the latest amendment of 2019, an Arbitration Council has to be formed so that that council appoints arbitrators, and then there is a panel and everyone gets the share, etc. But that is not that has not happened in so many states. So the whole purpose is that this case management will require all of these things. It's good that we have got it, I know, and it's not followed. Even the Commercial Courts Act, if it is followed to the brim, it will result in a lot of fine case management. Because the amendment to the CPC of 2016 lay down these principles of case management. And I've enumerated them in my presentation at the end, if you see them.
Correct. So anybody else wants to put any questions?
Or should I say over to Prem?
Oh, you are here already.
I disappeared for some time. Ramshad, do you have a question?
Not a question. Just share the. Could you please share, ma'am? That's a presentation slide.
Yeah, already she has answered.
That is already with me. That will be shared in the group. Don't worry.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Very much.
All your issues of management of case and court would be solved. Prem, please.
So, madam, I would just say that it was an astute elocution which was started with your illuminating nuggets of wisdom. And when I heard that entire talk, I'm reminded of an Indian proverb. Like, you tell me a fact, I will learn. Tell me the truth, I will believe. But tell me a story, it will live in my heart forever. Really very engaging talk, madam, by which you have synced multiple brains in this particular platform. And we were all so impressed by your intellectual stuff. And what an effective way of communicating. Really good at elucidation of ideas. And it was a well-structured presentation. And unhesitatingly, I have to say that now my mind is like a parachute, open so that it works. Thanks a lot, madam. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. So,
that brings us to the end of the 66th session. I'm sure that like all other sessions, we have very many things to take home, and we'll be able to benefit. We'll be able to empower ourselves with this. And today, let us first thing before we come back tomorrow, let us identify the big boulders and stones and see to that they are arranged properly so that we'll have a, I mean, at least a positive aspect of this COVID or the pandemic lockdown, I would believe, is that this exchange of ideas, these new thoughts coming in. We are indeed indebted to you, Justice Roshan Dalvi, ma'am, for this wonderful, wonderful way in which you simplified the entire thing. We never thought, I mean, for a second that, of course, we knew that there will be ways and means of management. We have these MBAs and others who will give you some sort of graphs and things like that and complicate it even more. Once we see it, we will believe that whatever system we are following is the best in the world. Let us not have this sophistication and things like that. But today, at least, we were able to at least be able to understand the simplistic approaches towards managing our own affairs. We are deeply indebted to you. Thank you very much, ma'am. And thanks goes to Justice Ramkumar sir and Justice Ramakrishnan sir for the valuable presence and inputs, and to all of you wonderful persons out there for being part of this journey of legal empowerment through interaction lecture series. So till we meet again tomorrow at 3:30, when Advocate Parimal K. Sharaf will be dealing with the art of drafting. Please take care and stay safe. Thank you. Thank you very much.